Welcome to worship from Colchester Salvation Army. Today's meeting is all about uplifting the name of Jesus. Jesus, the name above all names. And to be honest, the biggest problem has been what to leave out, because there's so many great songs about the name of Jesus. We're going to start off with All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name.
Your name. Jesus, the name I love so well, the name I love to hear. No saint on earth its worth can tell, no heart can see the dear. In there with all the blood bought from sin and sorrow free, I'll sing the new eternal song of Jesus' love to me.
So now we're going into a time of prayer, and we're going to feature a little chorus that says, Jesus, name above all names, beautiful Saviour, living Lord. Let's make this our prayer. Father God, we come to you in the name of Jesus. We want to say thank you for Jesus, but thank you sounds so inadequate for the enormity of what we know Jesus has done for us. We thank you that God so loved the world. And now we bring before you the needs of that world. Father, we start with our own church, the Salvation Army in Colchester, both at the Citadel and Mount Zion. We pray for those who need you in a special way. We remember particularly at the Citadel, the Ling family, Albert and Brenda, and thank you for all the years of service for you that they've expressed through the Corps. Father, we bring before you our town of Colchester and its many needs. And we bring before you our country, and we bring before you particularly those affected by COVID, by this dreadful pandemic, those who've been affected economically and continue to be affected economically, those who have health concerns, and the bereaved. Not just those bereaved by COVID, but those who've been affected in the last 18 months and been unable to really celebrate the lives of their loved ones. Father, we thank you that things seem to be improving, but we remember that that's just the situation in our country, and around the world the pandemic is just still rampaging, and we pray for a solution. We bring before you our prayers in the name of Jesus. Amen. There's a hymn that was written by Patrick Appleford called simply Lord Jesus Christ. Canon Patrick Appleford was responsible for Church of England schools in Essex, and Jackie taught in one of these schools for many years, so knew him a little. It's a great hymn, and I invite you to join with singing, particularly the ending of it, where we make our commitment to Jesus.
Isaiah 9, the people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this.
Thank you. Luke chapter 9, verses 18 to 20. Once, when Jesus was praying in private and his disciples were with him, he asked them, "Who do the crowds say I am?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others that one of the prophets of long ago has come back to life." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Peter answered, "God's Messiah." Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 to 16. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, Jeremiah or one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Mark chapter 8, verses 27 to 29. Jesus and his disciples went on to the villages around Caesarea Philippi. On the way he asked them, "Who do people say I am?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Peter answered, "You are the Messiah."
Thank you.
So in our reading from the Gospel, Jesus asked Peter, "Who am I?" Is it a quiz question? Peter helpfully lists what people say about Jesus, and in a way rehearses what people today say about him. He was a good man, a teacher, a philosopher. Did any of this come as news to Jesus? No, the important information was, "Who do you say that I am?" It's a personal question to each one of us, and the answer we give defines us. You might think that this question is a pivotal point in Mark's Gospel, the point where Christ's divinity is revealed, but it's not. Jesus' question does not begin something new, it merely takes us to a new understanding of the same story. Mark is upfront from the outset, the beginning of the Gospel of Jesus the Messiah, the Son of God. Remember that we've had 2,000 years to get used to that idea, but for first century readers, the boldness of this opening statement is breathtaking. Remember that we said a few weeks ago on Trinity Sunday, for Jews and Muslims, the divinity of Jesus is a real problem. Mark goes on to reveal just what the statement does mean. He quotes from the prophet Isaiah to show that Jesus is the chosen one sent by God, and that John the Baptist is the messenger who takes on the role Isaiah had described. After me comes he who is mightier than I, John the Baptist says of Jesus. The baptism of Jesus brings together the two crucial elements in Mark's understanding. Jesus' baptism reveals his total identification with sinners. And more such signs will follow. Verse 11 of chapter 1 is the ringing confirmation of verse 1. Thou art my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. The story now unfolds quickly. There is the encounter with Satan in the wilderness, which provides the crucible that symbolizes the battle of Jesus' whole ministry, and out of which he emerges victorious, a victory forged out of the steadfast obedience and resistance to evil. From there, Jesus moves into the world. He gathers his disciples, who are astonished with his teaching and his authority. Then came one after the other of the mighty works they saw him do. And for the first time, an unclean spirit discovers what the disciples do not yet see. I know who you are, the Holy One of God. From Mark chapter 1, 24 to 26. Jesus goes around preaching in the synagogues and healing people. The dejected find in him a friend. Friends let a paralytic down through a roof. So sure are they that the man will respond. And here Mark introduces something new. Jesus does not only heal, he has the power to forgive sins, which also brings him into the first conflict with scribes and Pharisees. Jesus is a rabbi, but a rabbi like no other. He teaches with authority. He dines with sinners. He helps the helpless. He defends the poor and the meek. To the despised, he gives dignity. To the hopeless, hope and joy. To the wavering, he gives faith. With him, the law is not an instrument of manipulation or control. Not a rock to crush the masses, but a liberating power to experience the joy of the love of God. No wonder that the people were amazed. Such joy, such freedom they had never known. And glorifying God, people said, we never saw anything like this. No wonder also that this is the point that Mark introduces the second crucial element. The Pharisees went out and immediately held counsel with the Herodians against him on how to destroy him, says chapter 3, verse 6. Throughout chapter 4, he teaches parables about the kingdom of God. Chapter 5, 6 and 7 continue to show the breakthrough of the kingdom of God in the works of Jesus. Tensions rise visibly and conflicts sharpen. They come to know him, the man of Nazareth, who spends his time with the people of the earth, who so easily defies the law in his identification with those he deems brothers and sisters, and who reaches beyond the boundaries of race, nationality and religion to find a faith such as he has not even seen in Israel. A man to whom the people flocked, recognizing, if only dimly, the servant of Yahweh, who would not rest until justice was done in all the earth. Then, and only then, comes chapter 8 and the question, having seen what you have seen, knowing what you know about me, who do you say I am? Now, this is not a question for the vast majority of our country, who do not sit week after week listening to sermons and do not know Bible stories. It was a question for his closest followers, and it's a question for us. We know the stories. We know what Jesus did. And through up-to-date testimony, we know what Jesus continues to do. So where do we stand? A good man? A healer? A teacher? Our living, loving saviour? But saying the right answer isn't enough. It wasn't a quiz question. The right answer does carry a prize, but it carries the necessity of response.
Thank you.
So may that be the response of all of us, that Jesus, you are everything to me, to us. All our lasting joys are found in you, because Jesus, you are everything to us. Amen. So, a benediction. May the grace of Christ our Saviour and the Father's boundless love, with the Holy Spirit's favour, rest upon us from above. So may we remain in union with each other and the Lord, and possess in sweet communion joys which earth cannot afford. Have a blessed week. Amen.
Thank you.